shorter respect to yesterday compared to yesterday because he said that he has less things to say. So the hands-on will start before compared to the other days. But this is not going to be a problem. So now I want to leave the floor to Sandro. And thank you very much again to joining the session.
Okay, let me share the screen. And let's go to the, so you should be able to see the iPad and the, and this will go to full screen for the time being. Okay, so you see the full screen first slide. Okay, so thank you for being here. This lecture will be a continuation of the previous one, and I will remind what has been done also a little bit before. So there will be some little superposition with the previous lecture, just to restore your memory. And so what will be the plan today? So, well, this is what I want to do. I will remind the main method that we are working. So basically, you have learned variation of Monte Carlo, it's a stochastic technique, but our variation wave function depends on several parameters, and we know energy stochastically. So as you have seen, some of you have done the hands-on, you have seen the energy proceed almost randomly decreases when you do the optimization, but and it's a difficult task. But this is something that is not a problem, and it's also common to the most recent optimization technique, for instance, in machine learning. You use this kind of stochastic optimization. And that's why there was a huge progress in the recent year that we can optimize several parameters, even within a stochastic approach. Then, well, this is something that you have seen during the hands-on. So the basis of the stochastic optimization, I will do some historical introduction. So first was introduced the correlated sampling, then the direct evaluation of the energy derivatives with stochastic error, obviously, and then the main method that are nowadays used both within the machine learning community and the Monte Carlo community for the optimization of the wave function, and in the other case for probabilities. So before starting, I spent a lot of effort yesterday to explain what is the wave function that we are trying to optimize, that I generally call Jastrow mean field. Because the Pfaffian describe all possible mean field state that in particular contain some pairing correlation, for instance, the BCS superconductivity or some dimerized state, so you can form a dimer on a lattice, and there is a natural bond that you can describe by an infield, but not with a single determinant. And not only, there are several other cases that where the correlation is non-trivial that can be described as the main point. I mean, we don't want to do all the details, is that we know that we mean field, it works very well. We have understood the band theory of insulator and metals, no, with this mean field theory, quasi electron free approximation. But there is something that we cannot understand so far, MOT insulator. So according to band theory, a material like copper oxide should be a metal, and instead it's a perfect antiferromagnetic insulator. And there are also materials even more interesting that are not only insulator, but they are called spin liquids because they don't have any kind of order, not even antiferromagnetism at zero temperature. Nevertheless, they are insulator and they have one electron per unit cell, so an odd number of electrons per unit cell. It is the magic rule that we have learned from Bach theory. So I want to say that I mean, this is the main stream, somehow, this, the main reason to spend so much time to develop this code is because I believe that if you put together these two ingredients, you can explain everything. I mean, I want to be too much explain, at least qualitatively. I don't say that this is exact, obviously. But you can explain all that we cannot explain with a simple unity. For instance, in one dimension, you can show, and these are facts, so it's not just belief. So if you take the prototype model of strongly correlated system in one dimension, that is called the Tomonaga Lattice, I don't know if someone model. And then you take our adjuster of applied to the Fermi gas. This is shown, of course, if you take the appropriate long range adjuster to be the exact Gauss state of the temperature. So the mean field is not to do with this state. Actually, it's completely different qualitatively as a Fermi surface, and it should not have. It's a non-perturbative correction to the Fermi liquid state. And this non-perturbative correction can be fully described by the adjuster factor. As I've told, an important property of this adjuster of mean field state is that we can describe antiferromagnet system. I know. Copper oxide is my favorite example, copper oxide superconductor. In the stoichiometric compound is a perfect antiferromagnet, and we plan in the future to describe this with our just of Pfaffian wave function that should be exact in some sense. If you do the so-called spin wave theory and you take an Heisenberg model on a lattice and you put the spin very large, also in this case you can show that this just of mean field is the exact ground state of this model. The nil state where you put this simply antiferromagnetic spin does not have the spin fluctuation energy. What we have shown is important yesterday in the carbon 2 dimer. Then there was we can describe MOT insulator, that is something that it can, at least in one dimension, this is rigorous. Basically, we have the same qualitative property of the exact solution of the Abbar model, so that you have that both the density matrix and the charge-charge correlation decay exponentially. By simply applying just a factor that is particularly strong in this case, to a mean field that is a metal. So you take a metallic solution, you apply the adjuster, and you get an insulator. And so if you do your careful optimization of the adjuster, you get the right qualitative non-perturbative effect. This is non-perturbative because you cannot go by perturbation theory from a metal to an insulator. And you get your qualitative correct, of course, you don't get the exact ground state energy and correlation function, but it's qualitatively correct. For instance, there is a lot of discussion whether this just of mean field wave function can describe superconductivity in a model where there is only repulsive correlation. Probably, I mean, if you take a model with repulsion, I mean, many of you have knows certainly the Cooper model. So you take electron Fermi gas and you put an attractive interaction, you find superconductivity. If you have a positive interaction, a repulsive interaction, and you try to do any kind of mean field, you get always that superconductivity is not favored. But instead, if you optimize together the adjustor together with the mean field, you find that you can have superconductivity even in a repulsive model. And this is due to the fact that you induce high order terms, that is super change, that have some attractive channel and somehow favor this kind of superconductivity. But I don't want to digress too much on this. In principle, also the Laughlin wave function can be taught as a just of mean field, as was drawn a very long time ago by Jane, famous physical review B. To take a mean field, basically you dress it by complex, in this case, just of, and you get the Laughlin wave function that is known to be almost exact for the fractional quantum Hall effect. And then also what I want to show also recently, I know there is one of the most important the excitement in the recent year from experimentally and computational physics, is that you can have system that, as I told, they are insulator, they should be metal according to Brown theory, but they are insulator and they do not even break any symmetry. They are spin liquid, so you don't have any spin order among the electrons. And there are models on a lattice that have an excess solution, fortunately. This is probably one of the most important progress in incorporated system was done by Kitaev to solve exactly this model. They are called Kitaev model. And if you think a little bit, this was shown later in some physical review by other guys, I don't even know. But you can show that this is this excess solution is of the type of this star. So you can describe this spin liquid with a Pfaffian function that I described before. So you have to have triplet correlation in your pairing function, and you put only a Goodswill projector, so that is a particular short-range just of on a lattice that, as usual, does not allow two electrons to be on the same side because there is a strong Coulomb interaction, and you get the exact solution of this model. So this is just for your knowledge. I don't want to, if you are interested, you can go to the reference or the Google the name that I've reported here. Anyway, let me revise what we have learned. So basically, again, the main ingredient that is important to promote our mean field to the wave function of the universe, I would say, that can explain qualitatively everything, is the just-off. But we have learned that in order to compute the expectation value of a correlated wave function, which just you take a simple just-off correlation and you apply to your mean field, X, you remember, is the many body configuration of 3N electrons, you can do only statistically. There is no, at the moment, any method without error bar that can calculate the expectation value of this correlated wave function without approximation. There are approximations. For instance, the first one that is known is the Hutz-Wheeler approximation on a lattice. That can be done analytically by somehow dressing the coupling of your mean field. But this approximation, unfortunately, is not satisfactory. For instance, sometimes it's also not even qualitatively satisfactory. It predicts some transition that is not verified. It predicts some metal insulator transition on finite coupling that is not verified if you compute the property of the Gutzwiller wave function. So that's the reason why we have to use Monte Carlo. So if somebody invents some method to compute the expectation value of correlated wave function of the just of mean fit time without error bar, we would be happy and we would certainly buy this. This is the configuration. This is the probability that we are sampling. Just to remind you, we just generate from a given configuration a new one that is close by definition. Why should be close to the previous? Because otherwise the acceptance will be zero. So, and usually the best thing that you can do, you don't move randomly all this position, but you move only one of this position, one electron random. You take one electron randomly, you displace a little bit, and you compute this probability, transition probability. And if you, so that depends only on the ratio of the new wave function square divided the old one. And you do a Markov chain, and at the end of the story, you generate configuration, and the integral over our probability distribution that is exact, this is an exact equality. So the mean of this random variable is the expectation value of our favorite Hamiltonian, ab initio Hamiltonian, can be obtained, is statistically equal. So this means by the central limit theory is equal, exactly equal, only if this n is infinite. But we know how to control the error on the right-hand side, and we have seen how. So basically, the error decreases like 1 over the square root of m. And you have just to sum what is called our random variable is the local energy. And this local energy, so basically at variance of the true expectation value that is this quantity, the fact that we have a single local configuration where the electron defined allow us to compute this quantity exactly without noise in a polynomial time. As I've told, to compute this, we have basically have to compute a Slater determinant that, or a Pfaffian that is always n cube operation. And then since the configuration is fixed, the just of by definition is a C number in the configuration basis. So you have to multiply this Slater determinant or Pfaffian times a number that depends on the particular configuration. For instance, is minus infinity if two electrons is zero, this correction, if two electrons with opposite spin are on the same position. So I don't want this configuration because I know that it's zero. And so the Markov chain, when you do this, will automatically exclude this configuration because the just will say that if I generated this qubit configuration, the probability to go there is zero. And you automatically do not have this in the sampled configuration. And you have, by this technique, the exact expectation value of your Hamiltonian. This is a brief reminding of, and again, we believe that this is a reasonable approach. And in Turbo, we have defined the most general wave function of this type, of the just of mean fit time. But the problem is that we have several parameters, and this quantity, the variational Monte Carlo energy, actually this not necessarily. Because we know how to compute by variation of Monte Carlo, again, I repeat, if you can find an algorithm that can compute this without Monte Carlo, you are welcome. And we can remove this BMC here. The problem is that so far we have to use Monte Carlo. This cost function is known only statistically, and on the other hand, depend on several parameters. For instance, the first introduced variation of Monte Carlo dates 65, so several years ago. Was a milestone work of Macmillan. For Helium-4, introduced a simple just. So this is by just of function, I mean a correction to configuration that depends only on the position of the electrons, that is diagonal in this basis. So you know the position of the helium-4 atom. They are known to be superfluid at zero temperature, a low enough temperature. And he proposed just this just of factor. Of course, if you don't take, if you take a constant wave function, this is a perfect superfluid. All the particles are condensed in the k equals zero state. But you can put a correlation term that depends on two parameters only, E1 and E2. And it was able by trial and error to optimize this parameter and show nice qualitatively correct property of this system. That was recently, there was some interesting work experimentally to show whether the reason there is not superfluidity also in helium-3, etc. There is still interesting subject of research in this field. But anyway, this is just to show that until not only 50 years ago, but also only 20 years ago, in lattice model like the TJ model, one describe the just of with the simple Tutzwiller projector, so something that do not allow you to have you work in configuration space again where the electrons and position are defined. The only thing difference on a lattice model, the position are on a lattice, not on a continuous space. And if you encounter a configuration with two electrons of opposite spin in the same size, you forbid this. This is the Jastrow, basically, the most used Jastrow on a lattice. It's very simple. It was tried to optimize the two parameters in the mean field wave function. One is the BCS D wave or the parameter, and the other, that is the different curve that you see here, is something related to the bump structure of this model, because you have an infield wave function that maybe may gain energy if you generate, I don't know, the next neighbor hopping or things like that. But anyway, you don't have to know the details of this calculation. The point, you have two parameters, you try to find the minimum as a function of one parameter, you have huge error bar, then you change the second parameter, and after many calculations, you see he has done something like 20 different calculations, you have the possibility to optimize two parameters. This was done 50 years ago, and also 20 years ago, this was the rule. So instead, now I anticipate we can optimize even 10,000 parameters without particular problem. More than 10,000 maybe is still a problem. So now let me describe what was the problem. So for instance, just to remind you that when you are doing density functional theory, R3-FOC, you are implicitly optimizing several parameters because, for instance, if your SLED determinant is expanded in a Playway basis, so all the orbitals that we have seen yesterday are expanded in a Playway basis, all the coefficients of these orbitals in the Playway basis are variational parameter or your DFT functional. And you can easily count that this number can be very easily 10 to the 5 or 10 to the 6, depending on the cutoff that you take in your quantum espresso calculation or whatever. And, but there is no difficulty because there is the self-consistent approach that you allow you to proceed with this self-consistent scheme. So here I report what are, for instance, on a lattice, if you have 100 electrons and 100 sites, you typically have to optimize 10,000 parameters with a self-consistent approach. But you can do on your laptop because you do the self-consistent field. No? You remember yesterday in the hydrogen, we have a bonding orbital expanded in a given basis. This defines me a new a field. I diagonalize the Hamiltonian. I have a new ground state of this Hamiltonian. Just the diagonalization of a 2x2 matrix, I hope 10x10 matrix. And then I do again the cycle, and at the end I have automatically many parameters. Optimization, basically. We don't have the self-consistence when we have a variational function. What are the self-consistent field that defines the adjustor? No, nobody knows so far. And this is a genuine correlated system. And not even we can define the self-consistent field for the determinant part. So what we can do? The first thing that was proposed date back before 2000 to 88. It was not very popular, but, and I will show why. So basically, suppose you have done, you want to compute the energy at a given set of parameters that are slightly different from they are different from the one that you have, different from a reference one, let's say. A reference one where you have employed the quantum Monte Carlo and you know the energy, for instance. So the idea is that we can relate the energy computed to a given set of parameter to the original reference way by the reweighting technique. Remember that what we are doing when we want to compute the energy at alpha is to generate configuration according to probability, for this probability, where the weight is the wave function square. So what happens, I will explain in detail the results. Let me anticipate the result. What you have to do to compute the energy of different variational parameter when you have done your Monte Carlo for a given set of parameter. Actually, this is an important tool that you have already used, some of you have already used in the Turbo RVP package. You have just to do compute a new random variable, which is the ratio of the weight, which is the ratio of the wave function that you have at the new value of the parameter divided by the old. And essentially what happens is that in order to have the energy, the energy at a different value of the parameter, you don't have to waste in the waste basket the sample that you have done to generate the probability that, that were useful for the old parameter. You use the same samples, and you have just to do the ratio of the new local energy, this has to be calculated, the, times the new ratio, this reweighting factor is called in cooperative sampling, divided by the sum of the sample that we have saved of this random number. This quantity will give you the new value of the energy in the sense that it will be exact if the number of samples goes to infinity. But why this is important? Because now you can do a plot, for instance, of the energy as a function, I don't know, one parameter, the delta BCS parameter, and this function will be exact. So you do, I mean, it will be an exact function that will have a minimum at some value of alpha without repeating the Monte Carlo calculation. So the idea of Umbrega was, why don't we do this minimization, this exact minimization on a given set of samples? And so we found a better way, a very practical way. So I can use Hessian method, conjugate gradients, or whatever method I like to minimize this function. And I remove the problem that I have the statistical error if I do several calculations. Why is that? Because in this expression, if you put alpha prime equal alpha, you get that the reweighting factor will be one, all one. The local energy will be the old one. So basically this will be exactly equal to the old energy that we have evaluated. So if you move only a little bit this variable, this will be slightly different to the energy that you want to refer to. And so will be highly correlated. So that if we go to the previous plot, if you want to see that this energy, I am at the minimum, I have to have the derivative is zero. So if I compute the energy to two very close, between two very close parameters, I should have the same. But you see, this has this error bar, this has this error bar. Maybe I'm right to be at the minimum, but I don't really know. Instead, if you do the correlated sampling and you compute the difference, as I've shown, you can verify in the tutorials, you can see that the error bar of the difference will be almost zero if the one of the, if you change very little the parameters. So I have to explain exactly how this, probably you can also, so let me go to the, I hope to see, you can see both the, you cannot see all the, no, you can see?
Yeah.
Exactly what I see, no? Okay. So let's try to explain the basis of correlated sampling. Probably, fortunately, I cannot, you don't see the, how can I show both? I can put this, okay, and then this is okay, more or less. You see also the other part if I am on the left. So basically, it's very simple. Basically, suppose that we want to compute A of alpha prime. By definition, this is this is with this notation, sum over x v of alpha prime, because you have to change the weight, times the local energy that I put of alpha prime of x, divided the sum over x of v alpha prime of x. And this, as well known, can be written as a probability, the mean of this random variable, over the probability that is this one. But now we can divide and multiply the numerator and the denominator by U of alpha. So this will be sum over U of alpha of x times U of alpha prime of x divided U of alpha prime of x times EL of alpha prime of x divided, so you get some umbrella average, sum over x U alpha of x U alpha prime of x divided of alpha. It is clear that I have not done anything. Sorry, this is alpha. It is clear that I have not done anything because this is the weight is always positive by definition. This is cancel this and this is cancel this. But then you can see that your probability again is this one, which is the probability of the original Markov chain with the parameter, with the original variational parameter. And this is, we recognize, is what we have defined the weighted factor. And this is the new local energy. So this means that there is another step. So I really have to write. But we should have time. So an umbrella average. So again, I will not do anything. I just put the names here. So in the numerator, I have V of alpha of x times R of x, what we have called R of x. And this is EL of alpha prime of x. Then I divide the numerator, just sum over x, V alpha of x. And then I have another ratio. And the denominator was V of alpha of x times V of alpha prime of x divided V alpha of x divided again this normalization factor sum over x V alpha of x. So you recognize that this is the probability of the original sampling. And so, and I have not done anything because I have divided the numerator and the denominator for the same quantity. So this is standard algebra. I have not done anything also in this case. And this is equal to the original probability pi of x times f of x E of alpha prime of x divided sum over x of pi of x r of x. So basically it's the ratio of two random variables, the ratio of the mean of two random variables. The numerator is r of x times the local energy. The denominator is r of x. But we know how to compute random mean of random variable by Monte Carlo. And it's simply, I sample pi of x, so the original distribution, And I say that this is the sum of the samples, well, 1 over n, so of r of x of the sample, times the local energy at the variational parameter of the sample divided 1 over m sum of the samples of r of access. So it's clear then, of course, this cancel, and we get what I have anticipated. It's just a straightforward division of and multiplication that you get you get a precise rule on how to compute somewhat time on how to compute. You see my screen and you see also my mouse, right? Okay. On how to compute the variational parameter to the new. And the important thing is that when this parameter is very close to the original one, as we have seen in the tutorial, actually we have done this to check if two-way functions are equal. I have converted a wave function that was an AGP with another wave function written in the same way with the tool in terms of molecular orbital. I want to see whether the numerics has been done correctly. So if I want to know that if the two-way functions are exactly the same, actually, the tool provided by Turbo not only compute the difference in energy, but also, if you have seen carefully the output, the overlap between two-way function. You can do the overlap two-way function by correlated sampling in the same way. And this is done. But why this was abandoned? This is an important technique. Was a PRL, actually. And the reason is very simple. This relating factor is something that, I mean, in Monte Carlo, the basic thing, why it works, I have to emphasize why it works, Monte Carlo. You know, by this relating technique, we have learned that we don't necessarily have to sample the wave function square that we like for obtaining the expectation value of the energy, but we can sample any other weight we want. And then we put the ratio of the weight that I'm able to sample with the weight that I should sample in, and I get the same ratio of the mean of two random variables with the ratio that you want, basically. And but why it is important to sample the wave function square? The reason is simple. The reason is that the wave function square is an exponential of something, as we have seen. The just of the exponential of any body there. I don't know, that counts the number of electrons that are close within a given range, basically. And how many electrons, and you have to see over all the space. So this will be exponential in the number of electrons. So the ratio of two-way function, even if you change very little the two-way function, I don't know if I have to show in the iPad. We have to stop at half past 30, so probably better I go a little, I'm going very slow today. Basically this method was abandoned because the when you try to minimize the energy as a function of alpha, and alpha becomes a slightly different, I don't know, 0.01 different, and you do a large system, you will get exponentially large fluctuation, basically, and you cannot trust to the formula, because this is true statistically, but as you know, only for infinite number of samples. But the prefactor that is important is the variance. The variance, so the error bar of the expression that we are talking about here goes like 1 over square root of m times a prefactor, but the prefactor explodes exponentially when you increase the number of electrons. So basically, when you use the correlated sampling, you cannot do a reliable optimization with more than 10 electrons. And we certainly with Monte Carlo want to do much more than 10 electrons. Otherwise, if we are limited to 10 electrons, it's better to use multi-determinant. You can solve almost exactly 10 electrons probably. So now comes the second progress that was done. And this is that we can compute without this exponential disease energy derivatives. So if we want to compute the energy difference between two variational parameters on a system of very large number of electrons, we will get exponentially larger bar. But as we know, if the variation of the parameter is very small, the error bar should be better and better because the two simulations are very highly correlated. So what about doing directly the derivative? The derivative is nothing but the difference of variational parameter very close divided the variation of the parameter. No? The difference in energy between two evaluations. And in principle, you can use the correlated sampling expression by Umbriga, derive it analytically, and get an expression that is similar, but not exactly the same. This is more efficient than the one that we will get. And then we can discuss maybe further why we have to use this expression. So the final expression is the following. You know, if you do Monte Carlo, you have to compute the local energy. If you want to do the derivative of the energy with respect to a variational parameter, whatever, our two-body Jastrow factor contains one parameter, B, we call A or B, I don't know. You have to define another random variable, which is the logarithmic derivative of the wave function at the given configuration, so fixed configuration, otherwise we cannot compute of the logarithm of the wave function. Once we define this, that is very trivial, for instance, it will amount to a stupid correlation between electrons. Then the derivative of the energy with respect to this variational parameter is just the covariance of these two random variables. Now, probably I have to do to define this, what is the covariance of most of you are not familiar with this probabilistic, and I go to the iPad. So again, I repeat, the mean of a random variable A is just an exact quantity. Usually we can indicate for brevity this is just the integral over the configuration of a part of your random variable, Rx, right? This is we have defined. And remember only these two symbol definition. Then if you want to do the correlation of two random variables A and B, you have to do the mean, and I call cov of A, B, should be the, any mean can be computed by, can be estimated. So, and this is equal 1 over M, whatever, sum of the sum. Of course, with Monte Carlo, we can estimate any mean. So the mean of the product minus the product of the mean. If you want, this is usually, you can see that this is an exact relation, minus. Is usually written like that. Why is this is an exact relation? You can expand this term, no? Maybe we can show very easily this. So this is A, B. Then you have minus A, the average of the you have to expand all the term, no? So you have minus A, the average of B, minus B, the average of A, and then AB, no? Plus A, B. And this is, by this definition, they are equal. So this is exactly equal to this, because minus 2 plus 1, this is the same, no? Minus 2 plus 1 is minus 1. No? Anyway, this is just but also clearly, all these terms, if you say covariance, it means that by Monte Carlo I compute this because I take these two random variables, I do the product, and I have several samples, I do the mean of this, and I do the mean of this, and this is probably, and then I can compute the covariance of these two random variables, and I get the result. Now let us derive why this is true. The thing that we have to do is to write the expectation value of the energy let me say that I replace the integral with the sum just for, so this, well, in principle is not necessary. Okay, let's, this is a, unless, because otherwise I, this is a multidimensional integral. Let's say that this is, I use the sum, otherwise we get crazy with the simple. I hope you understand, no? So sum over X, the property of the, if you are on a lattice, this is actually a sum. Huh? So you have the wave function square H C of X, or actually, this depends on alpha, okay. Let me think about that. Because this is on the continuous. Yes, we can write like that. And then there is the sum over alpha of C alpha. Let us, forgive me, I will not do the case where phi is complex because you never use the C is complex. Now we have to do, this depends on alpha because the wave function depends on alpha. And then you do straightforward the derivative. And so basically, when you do this derivative, you have to use of the, let's do the derivative of the numerator. The numerator. So I have, this is a product, no? HC times C. So I can derive first the left wave function. So So psi dot of alpha of x times h psi of x. But then I have to derive the right. But I know that the Hamiltonian is Hermitian. So in this expression, whatever I do, the application of h to the right is equal to the application of h on the left. So basically, you get the same value, and you have only to multiply by two this quantity. And this is as far the derivative of the numerator is concerned. Then you have to derive the denominator, and you get, of course, you have minus the denominator to the square, C alpha of x squared to the square. The numerator is unchanged, so sum over x, C alpha of x, h c of x. And then I have to derive the denominator, and what you get, sum over x, C alpha dot of x, C alpha of x, with a factor of two. So basically, you see, we have all the terms. We have only to replace these in terms of our probability and the local energy. You remember the local energy was hc divided by psi. So again, we multiply by, we divide by psi squared, by psi this quantity, by psi alpha, of course, this quantity. And we put in the numerator our weight that we use in Monte Carlo. So I have not done anything in the numerator here. And then we will do some manipulation also here. So the numerator will be 2. You see that this is psi alpha squared is the probability density that is divided by the normalization. So this will be 2 sum over x, our probability, times the local energy calculated, of course, at alpha, times this, what is psi prime over psi? Psi prime over psi is just the logarithmic derivative of psi. So you know that the derivative of the logarithm d over dx of log of psi is equal psi dot divided by psi. So this is nothing but the operator that we have defined for doing the derivative. Actually, if you want, you don't need to do the logarithm and do the derivative. You just compute the derivative of psi and divide by psi. It's also more safe, probably. And this I put O of x. And we have done the numerator. What about this messy expression? Again, you can recognize here there is the local energy, but there is nothing. So if you multiply and divide, and here there is the weight square. So you can easily see here I multiply and divide again by psi square, and what I get? Minus, so this probably requires two steps. Sum over x, the local energy times psi alpha of x squared divided our weight, sum over psi alpha squared of x. And this I have made happy only one of this square from this expression. So I have two times another C alpha of x squared, square is here. There is a factor of two. And this is, we have to rewrite this, so you can multiply by Xi alpha and divide it by Xi alpha of X here. And you recognize again that this is the O that we have defined, so we're getting the derivative of the stuff. And this is sum over X, Xi alpha of X squared times O of X. So this is a little bit more involved, but this again, what I missed here, derivative of the local n. Okay, yes. So you see that this is equal again to the sum over X of pi of X, the product of these two random variables, minus the mean of the local energy, which is our VMC energy at the variation of parameter alpha, times this quantity here is again an average of a random variable O of X and this is exactly what I have written in the main. And why this is important? Why this is important? You remember was emphasized by why this expression is very effective is important. It was emphasized by Michele Casula that variation of Monte Carlo has an important property, the zero variance property. And what does it mean? So that if your wave function for some variational parameter is the exact eigenstate of the Hamiltonian, the local energy never fluctuates. And so if the local energy never fluctuates, this means that the, oh, sorry, unfortunately we can see that what I have written there. The covariance, see if one of the, where is written the covariance? If one of the random variable never fluctuates, the correlation is always zero, because this is a constant, goes outside from the average and coincides with the average. So if you do this difference, this is zero. So also the calculation of the energy derivatives written in this way, in this particular way, has the zero variance property. So if you improve your wave function, you have more information. So you have more information on how to get even closer to the minimum because your variance will decrease and your direction where you where to move improves farther and farther. In particular, no, so somehow let me sketch if you this can be derived in a few lines. So I hope actually I can go directly to the iPad now for some reason. This is my ideal configuration. So if you take the correlated sampling, what you get? That the energy, sorry, the energy calculated at the value alpha prime is essentially equal to sum of X of the reweighting factor that depend on alpha prime. Of X times the local energy of alpha prime. And this we have seen is an exact on the sample. And this is an exact expression because you do the Monte Carlo on a given set of sample, that's what we want to do, and you are doing a calculation for any alpha. So you can actually derive with respect to alpha prime. These are the samples generated from the previous Markov chain. So we can do the derivative of this. So Umbriger would have done the derivative of this. And the only thing to notice, of course, you get, if you derive the R of alpha, no, remind R of alpha prime is the wave function calculated to a given configuration to the square divided C alpha over X square. So if I do the derivative of this, I get with respect to alpha prime, because alpha, and I tend to the limit alpha prime tend to alpha. So you get two phi of alpha, phi dot of alpha divided phi alpha square. And so you recognize this is just two O that we have defined. Huh? So basically you recognize that if you derive this expression, you get the same expression as before. Right. Let me shorten what is the result. So you get the covariance of the local energy times O, but you need also to do the derivative. R of X for alpha prime going to alpha is one. So at the end of this expression, you add the derivative of the local energy, sum over the sample, divided, the denominator becomes the number of the sample, that you have to add this. And why? And this, of course, this has the zero variance property, but the derivative of a variation of parameter, even if you have exact of the local energy, does not necessarily mean that, because you can be exact only for particular value, like in the Luttinger model, you have to choose a particular value of your variation of parameter to be exact, but if you change this value, you are not exact. So the derivative has no reason to be exact. And therefore, you arrive to this contradiction that can be explained since the two relations are exactly justified mathematically. This is a proof somehow that the average of the derivative of the local energy is just zero. So basically this is something that can be proved directly, basically. And it tells you that the derivative, this is a random variable again, the derivative of a random variable is a random variable, average is equal to zero. Of course, if you do this, you will not get zero, but you know that since it's zero for large M, you don't put this quantity in your calculation of the forces, otherwise you get, I don't know, error bar 5 or 10 times larger. So don't do this, and don't do the correlated sampling, because this was an achievement historically to understand that this is the correct, more efficient expression to compute energy data. Okay. That's done. Another 20 minutes, we arrive to the next point. Now we have energy derivatives. So the main point when we can compute the gradient is that we can go, we don't have to be no longer afraid to optimize several parameters. Because we know there's a standard method in computation that we can just follow the so-called direction of the gradient. Basically, even if you have 1 million parameter and you can compute 1 million energy derivatives, actually we can show that this is possible without, even if you have a function that depends 1 million parameter, you can compute without effort, without more effort than computing the energy, these derivatives, these OK corresponding, not the operator, the random variable that we have defined to do this energy derivative, do not cost anything. You will see that in the Monte Carlo, doing the optimization of several parameters does not cost much more than doing the variation on Monte Carlo itself. And so we have the possibility to follow the steepest descent, that is a standard method for optimizing a cost function. And so in principle, there should be no problem. The steepest descent is defined in the following way. Well, probably I can also explain in a few words why the steepest descent is robust and allows you. Because if you have several parameters, you don't have much, you cannot do one by one by end. You know? Basically, the point is that if you change the parameter, the alpha, that is a vector, let's see, that's for clarity, in the direction of the gradient, or minus the gradient, the derivative alpha, then what we expect, the energy of the original parameter, the vector again, plus the alpha, I just can do the linear expansion around the original parameter. It will be E of alpha plus delta alpha, what we have called delta alpha vector, times the gradient of the energy. And so if we replace this, you will get that if your gradient is non-zero, is different from zero, then your energy certainly goes down. D alpha, the alpha is proportional, so this means that this is delta. So if I replace this here, no, obviously you can say that this is d over d alpha square, plus, of course, since it's done for delta small, you have, if your function is regular, as we suppose we have not crazy to define a non-analytic function in variation of Monte Carlo, you will certainly go down in energy. And the only problem you do, you will, for delta small enough. The only problem is when this is zero, but when this is zero, you are at the minimum, because if this is d over d alpha equals zero, is just, if you remember, the Euler condition of minimum energy. Of minimum, not necessarily. Or minimum maximum saddle point. But of course, in this case, since your energy is going down always at each iteration, you have to go to a minimum. At most, you have you go to a local minimum. So if you iterate the steepest descent and you have enough computer time to iterate million of time, you get certainly the minimum. Okay, this we have done. And let me show a concrete example what happens. You have to do some effort to remember what we have done yesterday lecture. So I will try to show you a concrete example that you can do. Actually, in the tutorial, you have done an even more complex example. You have optimized the helium, the hydrogen tool in a very large basis. So what we have said that in Turbo, in any reasonable code, we use the just-off factor to satisfy the cusp condition. And for at least the electron ion cusp condition, we need one parameter A. For satisfying the electron-electron cusp condition, we need another parameter B. And this is the simplest just-off factor that you can think of. Then the geminal expansion, we suppose that converge fast after you satisfy all the cusp condition, but we cannot longer use Slater basis because the cusp condition are already satisfied by just-off. If we would use here a Slater basis, then we will introduce a CASP that you don't want because the CASP are already taken into account by the just of fact. So you have to be careful. We have some Slater orbital that we can use in turbo, but you have to remove the CASP, so somehow of this Slater orbital. So it is convenient to use a Gaussian mask. So we use 1S, so a matrix, a 2x2 matrix. But of course, by symmetry, you can multiply this by a constant. So you have to fix at least one of these parameters of the constants. For instance, lambda 1, 1 equal 1. So there are only two elements in this basis. But by symmetry, of course, the atomic this is described the atomic contribution that may be relevant at bond distance. So this lambda will go to infinity if we go at large distance, because the atomic should disappear. By symmetry, the atomic contribution that is on the first atom is the same as the second. So we can fix it to one, and we have only one variational parameter for our general function. So, and to be even a little bit more accurate, we optimize also the exponent that is also possible in turbo RBD. So 1, 2, 3 and 4 variational parameter. And we try to do our steepest descent. You can reproduce this calculation in turbo. This is a stochastic optimization with 4 parameters that is already prohibitive if you do the standard case. And you try to understand what delta I have to choose. Delta, you say, is truth enough. In principle, at each step, you can optimize this delta, but nobody does this. So you fix delta and you see what happened basically. And you see that this is the problem. Above some point, so if I try to put T-par, you can use the steepest descent in turbo RBD, just you have to change one parameter. I apologize, this crazy parameter does not mean anything. You have a number, but if you do this, you do the steepest descent. You can also use, thanks to Andrea Tirelli, the Adams that use also the gradients of the wave function that is well known in machine learning, but we have experience that you can try. You will see that it's less accurate than the method that we will present here. And at some point you cannot go faster. So we can, because there is instability. So you have to choose carefully this T-par. There is a way to usually to fix it automatically, but I will not discuss it here. Anyway, it's a minor work for Monte Carlo. You have to spend some time to optimize. So what does it mean, fixing delta? Fixing delta means that in principle, what I should do, I should optimize the energy, my cost function in the direction of the gradient, and said, but this is too heavy. I don't know, you have to do at least 10 different calculations each time you move, and you don't gain much. So this means that this equivalent to use always the same T-par in the steepest descent. It's equivalent to say, well, I don't know the quadratic term of this expansion, but I assume that I don't want to change too much the variational parameter, otherwise I don't believe to my step. So this is equivalent to say that I put a weight, a positive weight that is quadratic in alpha, that stops my calculation to choose a too large change of delta alpha. If you minimize this quadratic form with respect to alpha alpha, you get the iteration I go to the iPad, this is trivial. So for each parameter, your cost you approximate, and this is allowed because you know that for delta small enough, the quadratic contribution, the Hessian part of my function does not contribute much. It's not important, it's more important than the linear term. So this means that I have to minimize something that is f of k, which is the generalized derivative. Probably I have not defined what is f of k here. F of k is by definition the generalized derivative minus the derivative of f of k. So the cost is equal. Sorry, yes, you are right. I don't see my mouse. The cost is, well, let's not define this. So the cost will be delta alpha k is my energy. So d a of the alpha k plus 1/2 delta delta alpha k squared. To minimize this function, I just derive the cost with respect to each of the variational parameter. But since they are all independent, the sum, you derive one, and they is always the same. So you get d over d alpha k plus 2 delta alpha k divided by 2 delta, so which means delta alpha k divided by delta, which means these have to be zero if I want to minimize. This function has certainly a minimum, so alpha large is positive, and this delta alpha k is equal minus delta my gradient. So, and this is the steepest descent. With fixed delta. Okay. And what is the problem? The problem that we have done an answer on how much our cost function depends on alpha k. We are assuming that more or less all the variational parameter affects my energy landscape in the same way. But this is not true because the parameter that enter in my wave function, in a correlated wave function, enters in a highly correlated way. So for instance, you can have a parameter that change by 2 orders of magnitude and does not change a lot the wave function, and one parameter that change a little bit the wave function, and they change a little bit, but change a lot the wave function. So this is something that we should not do. I have another 5 minutes, I suppose. So let me show what is the disaster of the steepest descent. Yeah, report, since with this system small, we can do even 700,000 simulations. And you see that I have shown at the beginning only the first simulation, and you don't realize that probably the most important parameter that I've not written here. No, this is the energy, sorry, not the variational parameter, and this is the energy. You would expect, okay, I do in this step, I am converged, but you want to see what happened to the variational parameter. And you see there is one variational parameter that is actually the most important one, the one that determines the weight of the Eitler-Landau contribution compared to the atomic contribution. We have seen this is a peculiar. So the most important to understand the, what's going on in our wave function takes at least 300,000 iterations. You cannot do more because this is the maximum delta that we can take, you know? If we put 0.6, everything blows up. So, and if you try to optimize at each step, you don't get a value, you cannot get a value much larger than 0.4. And this is terrible because, okay, in the H2 we can do, okay, we can arrive to 500,000 iterations and we can get the result. But then the other problem that you cannot, if you do 1,000 iterations, okay, this is converged probably. But instead it's not converged. So it's changed by an order of magnitude. So this is a big problem. And what is the how we can solve this problem, and this will be the next part. Probably it's better to stop because otherwise you are more fresh. This is a little bit a good time to make a break, I would say, right? If
yes, we are on time on the agenda. Usually the break is at 10:30.
So, you fix that there is a problem, and I will show in the next part how to solve this problem. Okay.
Okay, perfect. Then now we're starting the coffee break. Let's come back at 10:50 for everyone. So for the second lecture made by Sandro Sorella. Thank you very much, everyone.
So good morning, everyone, and welcome back to the Trex eSchool. So for the next lecture, we have Sandro, who will be discussing the next session. So Sandro, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. I share my screen. But now we begin. I don't know how to... we finished here. So very good. Welcome back. And now we want to begin a little bit. I hope you are fresh. You can follow some little turnaround with maths, but it is important to solve this problem. So basically, what we have several parameters. You can easily reach 1,000, even these tutorials, I think, Osuke provided 2,000 or 3,000 parameter optimization. We can reduce the number of parameters in this case, probably using some similar. Anyway, just to see that it's not a problem. For each variational parameter, we have seen that if we want to compute energy derivative, we have to define random variable defined in this way. The derivative, we need the derivative of the wave function. That of course is possible, and actually if I have time, I will tell how this is done in TurboFDB. But we can define an operator. This X is a configuration of an Hilbert space, and you can define an operator by defining the matrix elements. So I say that a matrix element of the operator OK, that before was a random variable, now I have promoted to be an operator, so the tax on my Hilbert space is just determined by the diagonal element, so my random variable OK of X, which is the derivative. And I know how to compute this in all the Hilbert space, but the case where the wave function vanishes. And this in the continuous is measure zero. So basically, it's complete despite this restriction, this basis. So this is just formally to define that the wave function change is just given by this expression. And this is very simple to show, and I have to go to the so because you just apply the time of expansion, you see how we have defined alpha down, so alpha plus delta alpha of x is of course equal the value if the wave function is not zero, plus delta alpha, the derivative of C of alpha with respect to alpha, and that's it, at the iteration x. So I can multiply and divide the alpha of x times, actually, better to put on the right, just for aesthetic reason. One plus delta alpha C alpha of x divide the derivative divided C alpha of x apply to C alpha of x. And so this we recognize is our operator okay. So this is one plus delta alpha okay of x and C alpha of x. But if this operator is defined to be diagonal, this is equivalent to say bracket notation. So if you want, I put the next here. This is what this and C alpha plus delta is equal to 1 plus this operator applied to C alpha. The operator that has been defined here, because since this is diagonal, if you compute on any element of the Hilbert space, it will yield you the expression that is just a consequence of the time of expansion at first order of the wave function with respect to the parameter. Okay, so now I look again. I don't know how to switch in the way that I can do. So now an important point is to realize that all the quantity that we want to compute do not depend on the wave function itself, but the normalized wave function. For instance, the expectation value. Remember, if you define the normalized wave function, will not depend on the normalization of the wave function because we normalize by taking the denominator. No? So this is our physical space, and the normalized wave function is the important thing to understand. Its variation when we change the variational parameter. So in an analogous way, you can show that the variation of the normalized wave function is not the simple multiplication by this operator, but we have to subtract the mean value of this operator that is just the mean of this random variable coincides because this is defined diagonal. And this is very simple to show again. I have to use a few seconds going back and forth. This is because the normalization of a wave function is just the square root of the sum of the wave function square, and so if you do C alpha capital C alpha, this is small c, let's put plus delta alpha divided the normalization, and this is C alpha, capital one, C alpha, you get that the system is one plus delta alpha operator times C alpha. And then the normalization does not change. And this is the linear term of the numerator. But then there is a linear change here plus delta alpha due to this. But this is very easy. So C over alpha plus delta alpha with this is you have to change here, let's say, square that is simple. So this is equal to sum of C alpha of X. If I derive this, is 2 C alpha, the derivative of C alpha, which is equal to 2 C alpha square our operator. Is it clear? If you just stop, if you don't understand the passage, so this is so I just replace I will do a simple algebra, one of the C of alpha plus delta alpha is therefore equal. A little messy, so it's yes, of course, this is the variation. So this is means that this is equal one. The root of C square plus 1 plus 2. If you say, if you recast in this way, is the average of O. No? Because if you multiply the variation, you should divide up C alpha square, and this is divided C alpha square. And this is equal to divide by this to what we have defined the mean. And so you have to, and there is the delta here, delta alpha. So you have to do, you have to remember that if you expand this small delta alpha, the denominator, you get 1 alpha. So this is equal to 1 plus C square of alpha times 1 minus what we have from delta alpha. So now if you replace this quantity here, you get, and you remain to first order in delta alpha, you get that this is equal to 1 plus delta alpha O, the numerator, the linear order of the numerator I take, and then you see that the linear order in the denominator is just subtract the average value. Well, I hope you can do this straightforward calculation by yourself, probably more clean than I have done. And this is important to subtract the average value. This allows us to understand that now the physics in our space is not to change much the normalized wave function, because the normalized wave function contains the physics of the system. I don't care. If I change one parameter and I change only the normalization, I don't care. I can change the parameter how much as I want. I'm not doing nothing. I can move this parameter as much as I want. But if I change one parameter and I change a lot the normalized wave function, I have to pay some attention to do a small step. So the metric is not, in the previous case, in the theory, as we said, we have just a blind assumption that I don't have to choose to change the parameter. Any parameter is equivalent to the other, so I just restrict the parameter. But now I have a perfectly defined metric. That means that I want to change, I don't want to change much the normalized wave function when I change the parameter. So if you just use what we have derived before, this I go later. So what we have derived before is that the normalized change can be written like 1 plus delta alpha k the operator apply psi alpha. Then I can simply compute the difference psi alpha plus delta alpha minus psi alpha is equal sum over k delta alpha k this operator times psi alpha. And then if I want to compute how much is large this difference, so I have to compute psi alpha plus delta alpha minus psi alpha. I have to compute the normal, sorry, important thing that this was the shift. I have to square this and compute the norm. So this means that this is equal to sum over k, k prime, delta alpha k, delta k prime. I am just squaring this expression. So I need the 2 index. And it is something that is what is called defines a matrix that measure that we have called with quite an appropriate name, stochastic configuration matrix, where SK, K prime, if you remember, this is the normalized wave function, so it's just the average of this K prime minus K prime psi alpha. Now the psi, capital psi, that is not normalized, so I have to normalize. But we have seen that this can be computed by Monte Carlo, because these are just the value of the random variable. These operators are diagonal, so if they act on a given configuration, they take the value that we have defined. And so this is just the Monte Carlo average over the same probability distribution of OK of X minus okay, OK prime of X minus OK prime. And this, if you remember, is just the covariance in our probability of these two random variables, OK, OK prime. And this is something that we can compute and as almost for free. You have to do, because if you want to compute the derivative, you anyway you have to compute this random variable. If you know this random variable, you have only to update. I mean, you can compute with some error bar, of course, because when you apply the, when you substitute the mean with the estimated mean, you have an error bar. I don't know if I have written here the final method. So the final method, and then we can discuss the relation of this method with what is done, was done more or less, was discovered this approach more or less in the same period, probably even before, and with much more formal formulation with probability and Riemannian matrix. And as a matter of fact, this was this matrix is very important for stochastic optimization of probability function also in machine learning. Machine learning, and this called the Fission information matrix. We can say that almost trivially, that this is actually, there is only a prefactor that the difference, but it's exactly the same matrix. Let me show if I have written the final method before discussing the relation with other methods. Yes. So this the point is that now, instead of using the blind thing, we have to say something that tells how the parameter change our space. Our space that we are interested is not the space of parameter. Who cares if a parameter change a lot or without changing the wave function? We know that instead, if one parameter change a lot the normalized wave function, then we have to be careful with this parameter. And so the most reasonable choice to improve the steepest descent is to use this metric to slow down, so to control the way we optimize the parameter. And it's the same way as before, so we have seen that this is somehow is a Riemannian metric in the space of normalized wave function, formally. I don't know if anybody of you is familiar with Riemannian linear space. Is non-Euclidean, because this metric Euclidean means what we have used before, with diagonal matrix. And if you minimize this cost function, it's very trivial. As before, you get that we don't have to change blindly our parameter in the redirection of the force, but we have to precondition the gradient by applying to it the inverse of the stochastic reconfiguration matrix. I think I can go again to the notes. Again, this is a trivial, I don't know if it is too boring for you, but somehow the cost function. The cost that we have said that is reasonable to optimize is delta alpha k minus the direction of the gradients. We do the derivative like it is, and then we add the term that is quadratic, delta alpha k prime, sk k prime, with one alpha. Yes, we have said one over two delta. Then if we derive, you see now if you derive this cost function, because we know that for delta more than half, the quadratic, the Hessian term, we would like to calculate, and it's very difficult. It's slightly more difficult than this, okay, much more difficult. A part of the Hessian is computing, well, anyway, let's do the calculation. Then you get that this is minus d over d alpha k. Now you see that the variational parameter interact because the metric is non-trivial, and you get some, a factor two cancel because you can derive the k you are interested in. So this is misleading. Let's put the k bar. The k that you are interested in, it is either on the left or in the right, and so you get sum over k delta alpha k as you prefer to do is the second index as you fix the second, the other contribution is the same. And you get a linear system, as you see, S applied to the row of the alpha k is equal to zero, is equal, sorry, this was a plus, minus the row, the Coulomb done by the alpha 2, blah, blah, E over the alpha k that we can compute. And the solution of this system is, of course, you have to apply s to the minus 1 to the right hand side, no? It's increasing the solutions, delta alpha, the vector or the Coulomb vector is equal to s to the minus one applied also. The vector okay. And with the delta, because there was one over delta here. So this has to be equal to zero. This is the Euler condition of minimum of the cost function. And you arrive to this. But this is usually done, I mean, it's a standard thing that is done when you do a steepest descent, that is called precondition. The main point is that preconditioning with a stochastic configuration matrix is very efficient because you have already all the ingredients to calculate it. And as I will show, is very efficient. So we'll boost the way we can do the calculation. Yes, I have forgot. Well, let me summarize. So this is the standard steepest descent. F of k, remember, is minus the gradient of the energy with respect to the variational parameter, called the generalized force. It's not a real force, only force is a subject of a quarter of an hour. I will touch, I hope. And this is the method. Why this is equivalent to the natural gradients that was introduced probably a few months before. I talked about stochastic reconfiguration here in this paper that was published slightly later, but this paper was not exactly devoted to, I realized only later that it was very good for optimizing the wave function. So somehow, but so let me quote appropriately this, because even though nobody knows, knew in my field that the two methods were related. Machine learning information, you try to optimize a probability function that depends on your configuration space. That is the same. In our particular case, the probability is the square of the wave function that lives already in the metric of the, we have an Hilbert space. So probability function are not necessarily represent the wave function square of a given Hilbert space. And the Fisher introduced to parameterize this probability, the Fisher information matrix or Fisher information metric. Either matrix that will be the stochastic reconfiguration matrix or metric that we have seen, the metric is S squared is equal to Fij in this case, the alpha I, the alpha j. And the definition was they like they use E to say they ask the mean. So the expectation value of the logarithmic derivative of the log of P with respect to parameter K, the logarithmic derivative with respect to parameter K prime. And this is the Fisher information matrix. And P, what is P? Without taking into account the wave function, P is, let's say, some weight that depends on alpha divided by the quite generally. So if you try to derive the log of P, basically, essentially, the log of P and you put our wave function square, you get the factor of two, you get two, the logarithmic derivative of the square of the wave function is two OK, divided the normalization factor. And then you have to derive also the denominator, and what you will get that basically you shift like before with the average value times the alpha itself, because this is the derivative, you have to multiply and divide. So at the end of the story, you can easily check that this is the expectation value of OK minus O bar OK prime minus OK prime. But you get a factor of four here. This is our S. So this is the Fisher information matrix is exactly equal to four times the stochastic reconfiguration matrix that was used without knowing that this Fisher information matrix was already introduced for similar purposes, not for optimizing the likelihood of the probability function with respect to the information, the data that you have. So that is a typical problem that we have in machine learning. Okay, given that, I can show how powerful it is. Probably not a case because And before, before as mentioned by Osuke, when we do an inverse, we have to be careful because sometimes the inverse are very small, has very small eigenvalues. And you have to remember that our calculation is also noisy, so it's better you have to regularize this inverse. This is done also in machine learning. It's not an invention that we have done. What we have done that is particular, that we have found is useful, that in order to avoid this instability, is better to rescale the diagonal element of the stochastic reconfiguration matrix by a fixed constant. This in the code, in Turbo RVB, this constant is called par R, parameter for the regularization. And after this precaution, you can show again what we have to do. We have to fix this T-par. The regularization was chosen to be 0.01 and it's fixed. You can, the closer you are, the more faster you go, but you can have instability. But is now how much we can increase the par. We have the similar problem as in the steepest descent. At some point, of course, you have instability, and this happens when this T-par is equal 0.08, even 0.06, maybe, but you don't have to push too much. It's better to stay on the safe side. You do 20 iterations and you can understand. There is still an automatic way, I have to emphasize, if you want to do it automatically, you put by default input of Turbo RVB change T-par and it will do this job automatically with reasonable criteria. I mean, when you begin to have this strange thing, you don't have to use T-par so large. But then we can compare the convergence of the variational parameter. The steepest descent was taking 400,000 parameters. Okay, it's going smooth, again, what you like, but with the stochastic reconfiguration, with 40 parameter iteration, we basically understand also that this parameter lambda has to be close to 0.1. That was not possible, not even with 1,000 iterations within the steepest descent. So it's something that understand, since we have used a reasonable way to precondition our steepest descent. This is always a steepest descent, if you want. Precondition in a smart way, and then you can achieve for large system the accuracy required with a reasonable number of iterations. I have to show, for instance, that this was done very long time ago, even in very long time ago. If you want to be accurate, you have to try to go to lowest possible regularization value, if you go as fast as possible, and you see that also with 10,000 parameter, this is the two-body parameter, this is the energy, the two-body parameter seems to converge again with a reasonable number of iterations. I want to explain what is the reason. There is no the reason, probably you have read, most of you have read the numerical recipes and know that there is this difficulties with the steepest descent. And the point is that as a function of the variational parameter, the energy landscape can change a lot in one direction. So we have an hard direction when the energy changes a lot, and a very slow direction, the lambda, when the energy change very little. And when this the ratio, essentially, you do the Hessian, is a Hessian is the matrix that defines the second derivatives of many variable function. The matrix you can diagonalize. The direction, the normal direction, is the direction in the direction of the eigenvalue. And if the maximum eigenvalue is much larger than the smallest eigenvalue, the number, this is called the condition number of matrix. And you can show that if you want to converge with the steepest descent, you have to do at least a number of steps proportional or larger, certainly larger than the condition number. And the point is that in correlated wave function, the correlation, the condition number of the Hessian may be huge, because there may be a huge dependencies. And this is actually in this example that I have shown, I have computed the condition number, not of the Hessian, but of the SR matrix. Why the SR matrix works, the stochastic reconfiguration matrix? Because somehow is able to understand what are, even though it's not exactly the Hessian matrix, is able to understand what are the slow and fast direction in the optimization minimization. If you compute, and it is very ill condition as reported. So it's the maximum eigenvalue divided by the smallest is huge. But if you take into account this, so if you precondition your optimization with the stochastic reconfiguration, stochastic reconfiguration matrix, you basically feel reasonable number of iteration, because your calculation is not is no longer ill-conditioned by the way you have chosen in the nonlinear parameter that you have chosen, and that may be very, very entangled in your many body wave function, especially if you use a huge number of parameters, but from the physical energy scale. So somehow you know that the energy scale of the system that we are doing, especially with pseudo potentials, is of the order of the art. And you can have the minimum eigenvalue and the largest eigenvalue, physical eigenvalue of your system is not 10 to the 11, but is 100 or 1000. So that means that we can do, we can remove the entanglement due to the variational parameter and remain only with the physical entanglement. Let's say if you have a particular system where there is a very small gap and the largest energy scale is huge, you have difficulties also with that. Especially, you see that in all electron calculation, we suggest to use the linear method that take into account also second derivatives. I don't have time to go to the description of the linear method, because otherwise I will not have time to discuss one of the main good properties of 2PRVB, that is the possibility to compute forces. So I just conclude this part that should be concluded half an hour ago, that optimization of several parameters is nowadays possible. And this is thanks to the main progress done in two completely orthogonal fields that didn't talk to each other until a few years ago. Now they talk each other. There is a recent method based on machine learning for the optimization of so-called wave function with machine learning. I don't know what that means. And so there is also, I don't know if you have heard this recent work by Carleo to use machine learning to define more accurate variational wave function. So now the field begins to talk to each other. But the progress was done almost independently in the two fields, and that's why when we agree that this should be a good method, it's worth to learn this technique. It is also usable in other techniques. So we have also checked, things inspired by machine learning technique. So you have the possibility to use Adams, so without using any precondition, this will be very convenient because you don't have to do a very, very large inversion problem. So if you are able to converge, but we were not satisfied with the accuracy. The work that we will publish probably. And now we begin the new subject, calculation of forces in quantum Monte Carlo. It's very similar, so you don't have to worry, I will not bore you too much different or complicated stuff. The only qualitative difference with respect to before is that even capital R means atomic position, quite general. We have a system, I don't know, your carbon 2, you want to see if it is at equilibrio, we want to compute the derivative of the energy to see if it is zero, if the bond length is correct, or we have to increase or decrease the bond length when we do the optimization. So the wave function depends on the atomic position, simply because, as we have seen, we have to center our Gaussian atomic orbitals in the atomic position. So if we change the atomic position, we change also the center of this Gaussian. And another bunch of parameters, for instance, for the definition of the Jastrow, for the matrix lambda j of the geminal, of whatever. And this is always written as a probability, as an average of a random number that is a local energy that depends in turn on the ionic position. This is the, so that's why I've introduced an extra sub-index in the wave file. So what we have to do? Well, in principle, the simplest way to do the calculation is what we have seen, that it is wrong for the calculation of the variation. It is wrong. It is, you don't get the most efficient one. But you can start from the correlated sampling. So if I change a little the atomic position of the carbon atom, I want to know what is the energy when I do this change. And remember that remember that when I do this change, I have to change also the Hamiltonian, where plus delta R. This is taken into account because the Hamiltonian is inside the definition of the local energy. So when I derive the local energy with respect to R, I derive also the Hamiltonian. The Hamiltonian, for instance, the electron the electron ion attractive interaction depends on the relative distance between the electron and the ion. The electron is fixed because we have to compute the local energy at a given electron position, and the ions are parameters. So we can derive the local energy with respect to R. So according to this, we have to compute the reweighting factor is just the ratio of the wave function respect to before, and the local energy is, so what we get, what we obtain, and I have to go to the, let's hope that I have the, so this is a very similar calculation as before. The point is that, so if we are able to remember what is written in the, you cannot see completely, but we have to derive this, you know, the if you want, I derive with the thinking, even though it's not mathematically. So we can derive with respect to the air. So if you want. I don't know if this is mathematically, some mathematically. Mathematician can be worried about this notation. But essentially, if you want to know the derivative of the energy, we have a finite difference expression. We make this finite difference as small as possible, and we get the expression. So we have to derive the numerator, and the numerator, and we have to put the delta r equals zero. Remember that the reweighting factor, this was using the reweighting factor that is C of alpha plus delta alpha, no, alpha is fixed, r plus delta r divided C of alpha r modulo square. So the previous expression was the reweighting technique that we have written at the beginning of this lecture with this reweighting factor, the ratio of the weight function square when you change one of the two, the position of the ions. And we know that if we don't take into account the we have already shown, so I don't have to repeat. If you don't take into account the local energy, what you will get is two times the covariance of an operator that now is corresponding to the ionic derivative times the local energy. And remember, O of R is just the derivative of C of alpha R, because at this level, if you don't take into account what happened to the local energy, is over R divided C of alpha R. R is a parameter like another one, so you get the same expression. But now the local energy depends on R explicitly and in a non-trivial way, so there is no reason that it vanishes. So we have to derive also this expression and put delta R equals zero. So when delta R equals zero, this weight is equal one, and you get the standard average of the number of samples. So we have to add what in the previous case we have said that it's not important. The average of the derivative of the local energy of with respect to R. These are therefore, there are therefore two codes, and these you cannot avoid, because even though you can avoid some of the term when you derive, so it's a term that you cannot avoid. That is the usual way we divide the calculation of the forces in Monte Carlo. We call, since this is, when you do this derivative, you are basically deriving also the Hamiltonian, that is usually the same thing that you do. You remember the Hermann-Feynman theorem. It says that the derivative of the energy with respect to a small external perturbation, so a small change of the variational parameter, is the expectation value of the operator defined by the derivative of the Hamiltonian with respect to this perturbation. And this is basically the Hermann-Feynman theorem in this approach. And therefore, these two terms are called Hermann-Feynman contribution and Poulet contribution, because the first one will not exist if you don't have that your basis or your wave function depends on the position on the ions. If you have a Fourier basis, for instance, your wave function will not depend on the position of the basis, and you don't have to take this into account. But in our localized basis set, if we change the position of the atom, we change the wave function. And therefore, we have two terms that will be shown in the next slide. Actually, I forgot to put the factor of two. Yeah, I put the factor of two in the two notes. Well, sorry, you have to remember that the atomic forces are minus the derivative of the energy with respect to the atomic position. Sorry about that. This is the Born-Oppenheimer energy surface. And you remember the force is minus the derivative of the potential with respect to the atomic position. And we have identified the two contributions. One is obtained by the derivative of the local energy with respect to R. And again, this is something that we can compute in polynomial time. It's not something that is difficult, simply because we can compute the local energy at fixed position of the atom and alpha. So at most, by finite difference, we can evaluate this, random variable, because written as this, is the average of a random variable. And then we have a Poulet contribution that is the covariance of the derivative of our wave function with respect to the position of the atom and the local energy itself. So the covariance means that you have to remove the average value. So the simplest thing to do is to remove the mean of the local energy that is our variational energy. If you want, you can subtract also here the mean value of O, but you get the same result because this on average is zero. I don't know if I have, if there are some, you don't follow something, you can ask in the chat, I can be slower. Maybe I'm tired, I don't know. There is a first problem. So far so good. Okay, we can compute everything because we do our Markov chain. We don't have to change R to compute the force at the position R. We sample the original distribution at the value of the atomic of the bond distance that we like. And we are able to compute this random variable and compute that. The forces acting on a given atom. But in a variational approach, we have done a little bit weird, no? We have done something that is not correct. Because if we change the position of the atom a little bit, there is no reason that the variational parameter do not change. Especially because you remember that we have a variational wave function expressed in terms of localized orbital. And then we move a little bit this center of the localized orbitals. And we don't change any other thing. No, if you just for this reason, you can understand that if you reoptimize the parameter, you will change, you will have different answers. And this change of the variational parameter, you can expect that is linear in the variational parameter. So this means that in principle, to have the forces that are correct with your variational answers, correct means that I follow, each time I change the atomic position, I reoptimize my variational function. I've chosen to have a given number of orbitals to represent the basis. A given number of variational parameter for the geminal and for the just so fatto, when I change the atoms position, I have to reoptimize everything. There's nothing to do. And if I don't do this, I will get that my force will be not consistent because I have forgotten the change of the variational parameter because in principle, I have to add this step, right? By the chain rule. what I have done, what I have computed in the first expression is the energy derivative without considering the corresponding change of the variation of power. But you see that this is very simple to understand. It was some, and that this is the reason why we have to optimize the energy when we want to have structural optimization. Unless we have, for some reason, there is a special reason where DFT is particularly good, you get almost for free the optimal Slater determinant corresponding to the variational freedom that you have. And then in that case, it means that you cannot optimize given the position, since you have done a good job and you are at the minimum, you believe that the derivative of the energy with respect to the variational parameter at fixed atomic position are zero. This is by the Euler condition of minimum energy. And so you can neglect this term only in principle if you have done a very accurate optimization. This is something that has been appreciated. There are recent papers that, and also our paper, have shown this carefully. And you can be sure at the variational level that even if the optimization is stochastic, even if, but if you do a careful job, do several thousand iterations, you will find that the forces that you compute by neglecting this term, since this term can be neglected, is perfectly consistent with your energy landscape at the variational level. But there is a second problem, the second problem is more subtle and requires a little math. That if you apply straightforward, and I have to say straightforward, what I've said up to now, I was cheating up to now because the expression of the, also of the derivative of the energy with respect to the variational parameter for fermions, at least that is our case, is affected by the infinite variance. And this is very simple to understand if you don't want to read my naive mathematics. We can do this argument as accurate as we want, but we have two full pages of blackboard. But anyway, I think it's easily, can be easily followed. Suppose that I have my variational wave function. Remember, it depends on the atomic position, on the electronic position in a continuous way. So this means in particular it can vanish for a particular value of the electron position. The value where it vanishes is called the nodal surface. If you have 3n degrees of freedom, you have a big surface of 3n minus 1. Dimension. And this surface is very rough. I don't know. I don't want even to plot. But what you know, the catastrophe happens when you are very close to the nodal surface. So you can imagine that in this 3n dimensional space, I have the freedom to define one variable that matter, that is how far I am from the nodal surface. And all the rest, I don't know if you are smart enough, you can define the rest, that is the 3n minus 1 other degrees of freedom that do not change the distance n from the dotted surface. And then this becomes a one-dimensional problem. And we can understand what happens. The crucial thing is to understand what happens when you are very close to the nodal surface. So it's very simple to show that both the Hermann Feynman, but any derivative of the wave function, or our Poulet term, so the product of our OR times the local energy, blows up when I'm close to the nodal surface, like 1 over n squared, which is quite strong. And whereas we know that the probability function that we are sampling is going to 0 like n squared only. So basically, if you want the mean of this random variable, you don't have a problem because 1 over n squared cancels n squared. But if you want to do the variance, so if you want to do reasonable average when you do Monte Carlo, you have to require that the variance of this quantity has to be finite. But you see now the problem. If you try to integrate, all the other 3n minus 1 variables do not play any thing in this argument. If you change the other variable, we assume that we are always at finite distance from the nodal surface. So you have to integrate over only this one-dimensional variable. The probabilities vanish like n squared, but the square of my random variable, that is the derivative of the energy of the product of these two random variables, that is again a random variable, is going like 1 over n 4. And I think everybody of you knows that if I try to integrate 1 over n to the 2, this is not possible. In the present, all mathematicians agree that it's infinite. So let me only show how simple this argument is that we have the infinite variance problem. And you don't have to do many effort to understand that there is this problem. And it was realized, it is very simple. So what is OR? OR is the derivative with respect to R of the wave function at fixed position alpha R of X. And this we have defined the design. So it's 1 over N. I mean, if a wave function vanishes on a given nodal surface, there is no reason that the derivative will vanish also. So the numerator should be fine. So in principle, quite generally, this goes like 1 over n with some constant. You have to multiply the local energy times OR, the local energy that depends on R is again Laplacian, whatever the numerator, what is H psi, divided by psi. And this is equal to n. But if this, I am on the nodal surface, there is no reason why the Laplacian applied to the nodal surface plus the potential, et cetera, will be non-zero. So this also generally goes like 1 over n. The same argument, if you try to derive something the local energy, the numerator you can assume that is a smooth function that has a finite value on the nodal surface. You have only to derive the most important contribution is when you derive the denominator. And so this is HC computed at the configuration divided C squared, again, divided C1. Also, the derivative of this, there is no reason why it vanishes in the nodal surface, and this is N squared. Again, as soon as you do the derivative of not only on R, also any variational parameter, you get 1 over n squared blow up close to the nodal surface. If you have boson where there is no nodal surface, all the argument I was saying does not matter. And indeed, for the optimization of the Jastrow factor, that is a bosonic wave function, you will see that this is not important. You can avoid to use the regularization. But for any quantity that touch the determinants, the infinite variance is a problem. How to solve this problem? This is the second topic. Well, the key word is the reweighting method. The weighting term we started and we defined useless argument, useless. Well, this was was known also for other reasons. It's one of the basic, it's written in the book, in the first book of Monte Carlo, the reweighting factor. So it's not, cannot be attributed to Umbriger. But anyway, we use the reweighting method. And our weighting factor, well, this is probability proportional. So we have the freedom to change our weight in our probability when we do Monte Carlo, as I emphasize again. By no means we are obliged to sample psi square. It is convenient to sample psi square because it contains all the exponential variation of the wave function that we want to cut down to minimize the variance. But if we have infinite variance, we cannot do this. And the idea is not to sample exactly psi square, but if we are close to psi square, but we remove this infinite variance problem, we are happy. And of course, what we can do is to define something, a reweighting factor. So if I elevate, if I am able in some way to define a reweighting factor that goes to zero when the when we are close to the nodal surface, this ratio will be finite. When, so basically, you enhance the sampling close to the node when you do this, you change your weight. We have learned by the reweighting factor that once we use this reweighting factor, instead of sampling the bare random variable, we have to sample the random variable that was predicted before times the reweighting factor. So this blows up like 1/n². This, by definition, we were able, I will show how, goes to zero like n². This remains finite and we have no infinite variable problem any longer. So this random variable as a perfect, so the product of the reweighting factor times the original derivative of the local energy as a perfectly defined variance over this probability function. And so we can compute the ratio. Oh, you remember in the reweighting factor, we have to do the ratio of this random variable, the mean of this random variable, divided by the mean of the reweighting. And the problem is just solved definitely and generally. This was solved around 2008, basically. So not a long time ago. So how to define a weight that vanishes like n²? Well, previous attempt that does not work. This observation was done by Seppeli long time ago. Was to use a weight that is proportional to the determinant square. So basically, if we take Fx, the wave function vanishes because the determinant part vanishes. So if I take R of x equal to the determinant square, basically I have done my job. But we have seen that this is not convenient, because this is, again, the determinant contains exponentially fluctuating correlation, so it's a mess. You cannot work with this regularization. This is a regularization of the Monte Carlo. The correct weight, or one of the correct weight, in the Turbo they are implemented several things. The simplest one is to realize that if the determinant, so you remember, I hope you remember in previous lecture, that our wave function is the determinant of the Pfaffian of a matrix M, and the matrix M is defined by the position of the electrons. Is the dimension of the matrix is the number of electrons. I see somebody. This means that if we want something that blows like the determinant, by the Grouchet-Capelli theorem, if you remember, if you compute the inverse of this matrix, and the determinant is going to zero, by definition, by if you remember linear algebra, all, or at least not the particular one, at least one of the matrix element should blow up as 1 over n, the distance from the dot, the determinant of the Pfaffian. So the main regularization, and of course, if we want good sampling, this reweight factor should be as close as possible to 1. If it is 1, I sample directly my psi square and I have optimal sampling at least away from the nodal surface. So if you introduce a reweighted factor like that, this m to the minus 1, you square all the matrix elements and you blindly sum over all them. So all them. You realize that this, if you are close to the nodal surface, this blows up like 1 over n square, regardless how small is this epsilon that you take, and this will satisfy our requirement. On the other hand, if epsilon is small and you are far from the nodal surface, this will be a very small constant proportional to epsilon squared, so your weighting factor will be almost 1 and you are doing optimal sampling. So you have to choose the optimal epsilon, and you are probably tired. So I mean, wow, I have to do too many jobs in my, but you don't have to worry. Turbo has an automatic way to choose this epsilon that is optimal. So if you just run the, your variation at Monte Carlo and you put, as will be teached by Kosuge, it will automatically choose the optimal one. Not probably the optimal that minimize the variance, but something that you allow you to believe to the calculation that you are doing, because the calculation of the forces will be now done with finite variance. And this means that if you increase your number of sample by a factor of 2, your error bar decreases by a factor of 2. Said if you have infinite variance, this is the example that I can give you. When you don't use any reweighting, all of a sudden you get a calculation of the energy that is out of the in, out of any reasonable value. It's 1,500 times larger than the reasonable standard deviation that you compute by doing the normal rule in which, as was teached by Michele Casula in the preview, in the first lecture, you will get that the standard deviation of this quantity is of the order of this number, but instead you get value that completely non-Gaussian. This is really impossible to get, and also this, and also this, and also this. If you apply the regularization, you get the miracle and you can believe to your calculation. So that means that is important. Well, this is nice. Sometimes you can definitely solve a boring problem in quantum mechanics, because this is boring. I mean, you repeat, you increase by 4 the calculation, you take a value like that and you have to throw away your calculation. You don't increase the error bar, but the error bar increases. Instead, if you have finite variance, you are sure that everything is under control and you can send your job, your estimated error bar, and you go to the night to sleep and you go back and you find the error bar that you desire. So this is the more or less what we have learned, the basic, the two problems have been solved, but now I have to explain, at least to have, if you are, probably some of you will be curious to see how the algorithm works, how to compute all these messy derivatives. The local energy is an horrible object that I can hardly code. So let's see what is the code for computing everything in toolbar. There is one main routine that makes everything. That essentially is the input is the position of the electron position, 3N position, and the position of the ions. So what we have, and I have carefully divided this routine in 11 tasks. I mean, since we have time, I can briefly describe. First of all, the simplest thing, you have to compute all the electron ion distance and put in your, and you save, because you will use always this electron ion distance in our photonic calculation. Then you, given the distance and electron ion position, you can compute your pseudo potential big wall, big mass. Just think it's a black box that computes the pseudo potential contribution and what is that? The matrix elements that you need to. So, for instance, for the pseudo potential, you have an electron and you have to define the mesh to compute this around a given pseudo atom. And this is all done in this routine, defines all the mesh. You can choose the mesh, the larger the mesh, the more accurate you are. Then you have to compute, this is a trivial routine, the ion-ion distance. And I think here we compute also the Coulomb contribution to the energy. Then here begins the work, you have to use big matrix to save all the exponent. The dimension of the basis in turbo is indicated by this variable, Nelov. This is the number of neighbors that you need around any electrons to compute the pseudo potential or the lattice regularization if you are using the lattice regularization. I mean, you don't need to go to several things, but the point is that it's a black box routine that given the electron position and the atomic ions and all the variational parameter that can be 100,000. I don't know what is the record that we have reached so far, but even a million, you don't mind, give you the local energy and the logarithmic of, value of the wave function. So this is, for instance, if you have this routine, you would expect I compute finite difference and I compute what I need. But if you have 1 million parameter, you get time to get to the point. The nice tool that is used in TurboVB that again shows how close machine learning field is to Monte Carlo field. This is also done within machine learning. There are two packages, TensorFlow, that do this automatic differentiation. I want to introduce only to a very important algorithmic advance in computation. This is something old, dates to the 50 or the 60, and is that computer science have defined a way to compute all these derivatives with the same computational time that you need to write the direct algorithm. What I have shown that is the direct algorithm is a mess. Anybody can write this more or less efficiently. If you write it efficiently, this theory allow you to give you with the strength, what we have to do. You have to do essentially a translation, something that artificial intelligence can do nowadays. In fact, indeed, probably in the next few years, this will be done automatically and in several codes is done automatically. In only few subroutines of my code, this is done automatically. For reason that artificial intelligence is not enough advanced present, but essentially is a translation. So you want to translate from Japanese to Italian, you have to follow the rule, the syntax rule of the Japanese and translate to the syntax rule of Italian. And with this translation, given an algorithm that has some input and has some output, with fixed rule, deterministic, so they can be done by a computer, I can define an algorithm that is the adjoint algorithm that give me as an input, you see that you have to change your mind. Eh? So somehow, what was the output of the direct output became the input. And the input is a vector that has the same dimension of the output of our algorithm. In our case, is the local energy or the derivative of the wave function. And this algorithm will be able to give me, in one shot, when I call it, the derivative of any linear combination of the output. In particular, in my case, I care only of the derivative of the local energy, for instance, and my output is the local energy, with respect to all the input parameter in one shot. So the output of this input will be the input bar, as you see here. And the input bar, let's say in this algorithm, the input bar was, the input was the position of the electron and the atomic position. If I apply this translation, I click the button, I apply this subroutine that was done by something else. You can believe me, one day will be done automatically in an efficient way. And I read the output vector and I have the derivative of the local energy with respect to the electronic position and the atomic position. I do the calculation of forces, or I have, if I put this vector, the logarithmic of the wave function, I get all the derivative with respect to the variational parameter of the logarithmic of the wave function with respect to all variational parameter that are implicitly defined in all these steps. So this means that we have an automatic way to do all derivatives that we like, and we can do it in a computational time. This is theorem, computer science, that is similar to the computational time that I take to follow all these steps. So I don't want to enter in detail. Again, I emphasize, if I put in this algorithm one, I will get for free the derivative of the energy with respect to the, not only to the atomic position, but also to the electronic position, and you can put another, also to the variational parameter, same time, you can put everything in the derivative. And this is why Turbo is done. So basically, if you define a new wave function, you have to define the new computer beam, and then automatically you will probably one day have the computer. And this is the outcome. So if you try to compute forces, so this is a very important plot. So if you do your variational Monte Carlo calculation with VMC, you don't do any optimization, nothing, you take some time to do a given number of length of the Markov chain. Then with the same, and we can do the exercise in the tutorial, for instance, it's not done, but probably it will be interesting to compute the atomic forces for the carbon 2. You can check, then you put just an option and you compute all the forces acting, atomic forces acting on the system. And you compute the ratio of computing all the forces acting on the system the CPU time that you take divided by the CPU time that you do only for computing the energy. So after this, you will say, why I have to compute only the energy with Monte Carlo? I compute several things. And for instance, here is if you have 32 water molecules, each molecules has three atoms has 9 components. So this means is almost 300 force component, and you get almost with the same time that you do the BMC. If you would do this with finite difference, so you have to do a small change of the atomic position. And this was done, it's not a stupid thing. This was done 10 years ago, let's say, 10, 15 years ago. Now there are methods that compute efficiently the forces even without applying algorithm differentiation. It's irrelevant. Anyway, the power of this method is that you can compute everything. And you, as complicated as you want the wave function you define, you get two order of magnitude improvement. If we want, as we have done, the molecular dynamics simulation of water in at ambient pressure, ambient condition. This is very important, and for this, I think I can leave the floor to questions if there are questions. Otherwise, I can continue a little more. So, no question?
If you guys have any question, please just unmute yourself and ask the question to Sandra.
We don't have 40 minutes, but.
Yeah, we still have 10 minutes before the break. Or just write your question on the chat and we will read it to Sandra. We don't have questions, Sandro, if you want to.
No, I can discuss something which I didn't expect to discuss, but to give you the flavor of the algorithm.
Yeah, we still have 10 minutes, so. Yeah,
so I can discuss a little bit more for people. So for people that is interested, that is also a purpose of this T-Rex. We have to put our codes and we have to follow the architecture development. And I think it is interesting, even though these are open, to see open source. To revise you some technical aspect of Turbo RVB and how we are trying to follow this important algorithmic, high performance computing development that so this I can jump, but essentially we will have in the near future, and we already have, computers that are based on GPU. GPU are very, very good machine for this problem because they can do much faster than GPU, especially when we have large system. You can see a plot that I have done of the performance that you can get with GPU as compared to normal CPU in the standard BLAST2 calculation. You see that BLAST2 is a matrix vector and BLAST3 is a matrix matrix. Monte Carlo can be recasted as a BLAST2 calculation basically, but you see what happens. Our purpose is to do large system. And the main feature of GPU is not only that it's becoming faster if the system is large, if you do 10,000, but also because the GPU becomes very, very inefficient for this kind of operation when the matrix is very large. If we do 5,000 electrons, we will probably take a huge amount of time to do your calculation with the normal GPU. And instead, if you use GPU, you can only gain. You can only go faster if you do large size. So the reason why I was tremendously excited about the GPU acceleration is because I can solve, I want to do very large system with Monte Carlo. I hope it's to arrive to 10,000 electrons. And with GPU, there is a path. Especially if you consider that in this calculation of derivatives, most of the calculation is done with matrix-matrix. So you can gain with respect to GPU a factor that even for 1,000 electrons for this particular calculation is about 24 times faster. Of course, this is in theory. In Turbo, you can also use GPU, and we are doing some progress. So these performances refer to almost 6 months ago. We have improved by 50% probably these numbers. So if you do 300 electrons and you do variation on Monte Carlo, you improve only 20%, and you improve almost by a factor of 2 if you do the DMC. Well, what is impressive, as you see, that when you go larger and larger, and if we can do 10,000 electrons, we expect that to save almost a normal magnitude, even with the very simple algorithm that we have used and I will describe in the forthcoming slides, if some of you probably is interested. How is done? So this improvement is also as an ecological impact. You have to remember that we are computer scientists that spend a lot of electric power for these calculations. And environmentally, GPU needs much less. So you can get this factor is even larger if you measure this for the electric power that you consume. So this means that is already by using GPU in Marconi. Marconi is the Italian way, probably because we have won the European Cup. I think we have a better machine in this respect. Fugago has a huge number of processors, but we can save more power, almost 5 times more electric power if we use GPU, which is a reasonable job for our environment. So this is, I remind only the what we have to do in Turbo RVB. We have to compute the Jastrow factor and the pairing function. Sorry, the notation are slightly different now. But it's essentially, and this is the localized basis. So the main approach, the main task that we have to do is to compute the pairing function in the position of the electron up and the electron down. So this is a big matrix, IJ that I called MIJ, sorry. How this matrix is computed and you have to store during the computation. Sorry, this is something that I can skip. I mean, this is just to show that if the matrix is particular, you recover the Slater determinant in a simple way. The strategy is then we have recognized all the blast 2 and the blast 3 routine, and then we have just used the routine developed and optimized by the engineer, so that do much better job than us. As you see, many of the operations can be written as blast operation. Or for instance, you first load the matrix of the or that defines your basis. So you have to compute your basis set in all positions of the electrons. So it's a huge job. And for any element of your basis, this is a huge matrix. Then you have to compute the inverse of this matrix. This is also a BLAS, a LAPACK operation that we have used, the QBLAS for this case. No, the QSolver, sorry, library provided by. And then here you recognize a matrix vector operation that is linked to the QBLAS. Also, if you want to update the inverse, this is a well-defined, well-known BLAS operation. It's a rank one update, which is called DGER in the standard BLAS. So everything can be done more or less on this. So what is the strategy for ISA for doing variation of Monte Carlo? In variation of Monte Carlo, we have to change the position of one electron from one to another position. And in this, I say that what is done by the GPU and what is done by the GPU. In the GPU, we compute all the wave function value. This is very fast in the GPU. And we transfer this to the GPU and we do this matrix vector operation with the GPU. So we transfer only one vector, so that is fast operation because it's a small quantity, but all the matrix have to be stored and present in the GPU. So this operation can be done fast only if all the matrix are in the GPU. And then if the move is accepted, we update all this. This is essentially the strategy that is that we are working on, and basically, this is efficient in variation of Monte Carlo and is even more efficient in lattice regularized DMC that I want to know. And this is something that I have shown that is done with algorithm differentiation. And of course, if you have put in the GPU the direct path, you can put in a very simple way also the adjoint subroutine, and you can do everything, almost part of the code with thanks to the GPU acceleration. So if somebody wants, is particularly interested, I can show how to use the GPU in Drupal. In the present tutorials, you are only using GPU in Marconi. For small system, if you don't do 300 electrons, it's better you forget. Now we are decreasing. Probably the threshold where it's useful to use the GPU is 200, 250. Huh? But because there are several things to optimize. But certainly for our target to do realistic system, copper oxide, easily we can exceed 2,000 or 3,000 electrons. And the GPU acceleration is really something that we cannot lose, a big factor of acceleration that we cannot lose if we want to do Monte Carlo and we want to protect our environment, not to consume too much power. Okay, so, or at least for this reason. Thank you for your attention and we will meet again. Now I am on time, right?
Yes.
We can leave and unfortunately without, because we don't have time.
Yep, and thank you so much, Sandro, for doing the first two lecture for today. So we're going to have our lunch break now and we will reconvene by 1:30 and they will start the third lecture for today, which will be hosted by Kosuke Nakano. So enjoy your lunch and see you later. Okay, good afternoon, everyone. I hope you had a great lunch. So we're now starting the final lecture for today. And I'll give the floor now to Kosuke, who will discuss the wave function optimization. Go ahead, Kosuke.
Okay, welcome back, everyone. Can you hear me clearly?
Yes.
Okay, sure. So shall we start? So, okay, today I am talking about, Okay, I'm talking about two topics today. One is single shot VMC, actually input how we can set up an input file for WB calculations. And the other topic is VMC forces, which is actually a bit advanced. And the force calculation is not included in the tutorial. This summer school, but maybe I guess some of you are interested in force calculation. So I will explain how to do, and actually in practice, what we should do, be careful about, okay? So today in the tutorial session, the hands-on session, we will do VMC optimization, okay? VMC optimization and VMC, okay? So tomorrow we will do LRDMC calculations with the optimized web function so far. Okay, so, and today I explain, okay, the input file for VMC calculations, WBs. Okay, so actually this is a typical input file for a VMC calculation in WB. As you have already seen, the input file for the VMC calculation is much simpler than the errors, right? So you should, essentially you should put this ngen. This is enough. Ngen is, as I told yesterday, ngen times nw. Nw, you can also specify here nw, but the default value of nw, the number of workers, is the number of MPI processes, okay, you are going to use in your VMC calculation. Okay, so, and then finally you can get the total energy of your system and the its variance, okay? And then, so let's say it's very simple, right? So actually I do not have to explain much here. So, okay, here. And sorry, only one I would like to say is that if you, as you have already traced, you have already seen in my tutorial, if when you want to do a correlated sampling, you should switch this I red on, okay? If you, when you want to do a correlated sampling to check the difference in energies between two wave functions, typically after the conversion of one wave function, you should put here I red equal 3, okay? And after this, the VMC calculation, you should run read forward X. Actually, this is the main engine for doing correlated sampling using the generated Markov chain, okay? By this VMC calculation. As I told you, in the VMC calculation, we average the local energies, right, obtained by the Markov chain. And all the local energies and also derivatives, if necessary, are stored in this FOT 12.5. So please don't delete this port 12.5 after your calculation. Actually, you cannot, this is a binary file, so you cannot see, you cannot check the values stored in port 12 by, you know, you using a text editor. But for example, by using a simple Python script, you can see the values stored in port 12. But in general, it is not necessary. So one of my students yesterday asked me what values are stored in the 412. So that's why I put here. So, but anyway, the please do not delete 412 file, okay, after your calculation. And so after calculating, you after running your VMC calculation using such very simple input, you can unfortunately tab Arbor B does not provide total energies in their output file to get total energy and as well as forces. You should do a post processing using this force vmc.sh. Okay, so in tab Arbor B, and you should specify here. You should specify here three variables. One is beam and init, and the other one is bool A, okay? Actually, which is equivalent to this command, tabrogenius sh-j vmc post. This command actually does this tab rbb command, okay? And beam is the length of rebroking size, okay? So as Professor Kasula explained to you 2 days ago in the morning session, the Markov chain are actually correlated. So to estimate the variance correctly, we should treat several consecutive Markov chain as one Markov step, right? To estimate the variance. So this bin specifies the length of the rebroken sides. Okay. So and Markov chain Monte Carlo in general, not only in the in variational Monte Carlo calculation, for example, in the machine learning field, also we should disregard the first several steps because they are not equilibrated, right? So here in it, we can specify the length of the equilibration steps, okay? The equilibration steps is init times beam. Actually, sorry, init times beam minus one, essentially. So the first steps that will be used in the folder average is can be specified in it. Okay, if you specify here five and if you and beam 10, the let's say so the from 50 iterations, okay, you the tab force VMC SH does average the average, okay, the the local energy. And here pool A, this is usually so preset here. One actually, you can also omit this pool A because the default value was one. So you can also put the false VMC dot bin in it. That's it. Okay. So and finally, you obtain like this two files, and one is energy. Energy is stored in pip 0d. For example, here you can see the final variational energy and its error. Okay, you can also see variance. And if you specify, if you have calculated forces, you also get this force VMC dot file, okay, in which all the force component and force and its error bar is stored. Actually, forces, yes, are stored in this file. I'll explain the detail of this file, yeah, okay, later. So let me explain the force VMC forces. Okay, so as in this morning session, as Professor Sorella explained to you, one of the most important features in the of tab RBB is we can calculate forces. Okay, atomic forces. Let's say not only general forces, but also atomic forces are calculated very 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 efficiently thanks to an implementation of the adjoint algorithmic differentiation. Okay, explained by Professor Sorella in this morning. Okay, I think other QMC code, the one of the let's say one of the reasons we recommend the use of tab RBB for QMC calculation is this one. I don't think other QMC code can calculate forces very efficiently, as far as I remember. So as a consequence, so in TurboBB, we can also perform structural optimizations and Langevin molecular dynamics. So let's say QMC-based, QMC-force-based molecular dynamics are also possible by TurboBB, which is very, for example, useful for studying phase diagrams of materials in an extreme condition. For example, the Professor Sorella has already published a paper about the study of the phase diagram of hydrogen and helium mixture in Jupiter, I think. So in extreme, very high pressure condition. In that case, DFT, exchange correlation function, does not have predictive power for so due to the lack, you know, the lack of the exchange correlation function is not guaranteed, right? Because no one knows if the exchange correlation function is accurate under such extreme condition. Okay, so but in that case, QMC forces are very useful for calculating, studying such extreme condition materials. Okay, so and if you want to calculate forces at the VMC level, you should, okay, in the input file is as simple as before, but you should put here, okay, so ipscat is epsilon for, as in the morning session, Professor Sorella explained to you, right? So epsilon for a finite variant sampling of the forces, the derivative. So if the ipscat is automatically adjusted during the optimization in TurboBB, so you do not have to specify it explicitly. So you can comment out, let's say here, ipscat, okay? So if you want to calculate, when you want to calculate the forces, you should put here in the parameter name list, iskin equal one, okay? So this is not the correct example. So you should put here iskin equal one just to calculate the forces. That's all, okay? So, and then in fourth term, we should also specify what forces are calculated by VMC, by the VMC calculation. Okay, as a default, TurboRBB automatically recognizes the symmetry of the structure unless you put no sim equal true in make 14 input. Here you can see a tag in the 14 file in which what forces are calculated written. Okay, so here, for example, this one is also TurboRBB consider symmetries of the forces. Okay, so here, if you see like this line, one means the number of force, okay, and here atom index and direction, okay, so this means that, okay, if force in the z direction of atom one will be calculated if you switch on iskin equal one, okay? And if you see such a line, it means that, okay, there are two equivalent force component in this 410, and here two means, okay, there are two equivalent forces, okay? And one is F1x here, and the other one is minus F2z, okay? So this minus three means F1x equal minus F2z, okay? In general, TurboRBB actually make 14x automatically recognize the symmetry. So you do not have to care about that. But before doing a VMC, your VMC calculation, we recommend you should check these lines, okay, in 410, okay? And so let me explain the format of 410. False VMC dot. Okay, in false VMC dot, you can see several lines, okay? So, and essentially force is calculated based on this formula, as explained by Professor Solera in this morning. So a force is composed of two components. One is this one. We call this Hellman-Feynman term, and which corresponds to this line, okay? Their ELOC, derivative of the local energy, okay, here you can see, right? And the other term is Poulet term. We call Poulet term here, and the Poulet term is written here, okay? And the total one is this one. And the error bar is this one, okay? So if you, for example, if we put, for example, you can put, you know, the forces as you want. So if you calculate, when you have calculated four force components, you can see force component from 1 to 4, okay? And so from practical, real research, okay, project, this has been also already explained by Professor Solera in this morning. We should be careful about the consistency between energy derivative versus with force, okay, in quantum Monte Carlo calculations. Because as I told you, there are additional terms when evaluating forces in quantum Monte Carlo, not only Hellman-Feynman and Poulet terms, but also these derivative terms, okay? So if these additional terms are zero, for example, there are two cases. Okay, one is the system is already, the variation of a function is already at the variation minimum. It means that, okay, E delta C, round E down C equals zero. In that case, these terms vanish, right? So in that case, this force should be consistent with the derivative of the energy is consistent with these terms, okay? In that case, the potential energy surface, let's say the potential energy surface is consistent with the forces. Okay, as I show later. Okay, so actually this condition should be satisfied if we use JAGP ansatz and optimize the variation parameters, okay? But the point is, the problem is that if we use a J Slater determinant function, okay, J Slater determinant function, it means that we do not optimize the variational parameters in the molecular orbital, right? So in that case, we are not 100% sure these conditions are satisfied for all variation parameters, right? So in that case, the potential energy surface could be inconsistent with the forces. This never happens in the DFT calculation, okay? So we should be careful about that for real research project, okay? So I'll show the examples, okay? They are all electron calculation, all electron VMC calculations, okay? And the carbon monoxide, the CO, just the factors were optimized for each CO distance, okay? This purple one is the potential energy surface, okay? With respect to this CO distance, okay? The unit is angstrom. And the derivative of the potential energy surface is black one, okay? Dx. And on the other hand, this blue one is the force. Blue ones are forces obtained from these terms. Okay. So there are two cases. One is I used the CCV double zeta, which is a bit small. Let's say a bit smaller basis, and the other one is CCP quadruple zeta, which is actually typically is large enough for quantum Monte Carlo calculation. Okay, if the basis set is smaller, in this case, the variation parameters, it's not optimal. Variation parameters are not optimal at the DFT level. So that's why the additional terms play some important role when calculating forces. So in this case, the potential and the black line is not consistent with the blue one, right? So it means that forces are not correctly evaluated in VMC calculation, unfortunately. So, but in this case, as far as we use a large basis, sufficient large basis, the forces is consistent with the potential energy surface. Okay, for real research project, we strongly recommend that you should confirm your obtained forces consistent with the potential energy surface one. Okay. And actually, this is there's another problem, very important problem for force calculations for periodic boundary condition calculation. As I told you, the choice how to choose the basis set for periodic boundary condition calculations are not trivial compared with the open boundary condition calculations. Okay, so. As I told you, unfortunately, provided the basis set for open systems are redundant for periodic cases. So I 2 days ago, I recommended you that you should cut several smaller exponents, right? Typically smaller than 0.10, okay? And this is also true for PBC, all electron calculations, okay? This is very important, actually. If you want to calculate the forces at finite variance, so we very recently found that this condition number plays, the condition number is actually the condition number means the linear dependency of the basis set. So if your basis set is too very redundant for a periodic boundary condition calculation, the overlap matrix of the basis set, okay, is ill-conditioned. It means that ill-conditioned means that the condition number should become very large, okay? So, and we recently found that this condition number, the redundancy of the basis set is very important to get to calculate forces, okay? So, here, the left graph shows that the error bars of the energies are shown by blue squared, okay, here. So when calculating energies, the condition number, even if the condition number is very large, the error bars do not blow up, but when calculating forces, this is inverse condition number of overlap matrix. Okay, so if the basis set is very redundant, the forces obtained by the VMC calculations do not make sense anymore. So you should use non-redundant basis set for calculating forces of periodic boundary condition systems. Okay, this is very important when calculating forces. To do so, actually there are two options. One is just cutting smaller exponent of the provided basis set. Okay, for open system of periodic boundary, for pseudo-potential and all electron calculations, so both. And the other option is that the turbo RBB DFT calculation, so PrepX implements, PrepX, there is an option called IPS over. So IPS over, if we put IPS over, for example, equal 10 to the minus 7, the prep automatically cuts redundant basis set so such that the overlap matrix becomes 10 to the minus 7, okay, if it's over. So this beautifully works for periodic boundary condition calculations that we have already confirmed. And by which we can also we can achieve the phonon dispersion calculation. We can now combining with so the other external package, which is called phonon P. Now it is possible to calculate also phonon dispersion calculation based on the VMC forces, unfortunately, but thanks to the improvement of the error of forces using this technique. Okay. Sorry, this is a bit advanced. So actually in this summer school, we do not include the force calculation examples. So if you are interested in force calculations, so you should have, so please feel free to contact